where the government is dictating particular religion or particular prayer.
And, well, and an example that comes to mind is a few years ago, the governor of Alabama had his son draft an official prayer to be used in Alabama schools. And these people saw nothing wrong with that. And of course, you know, if you say that's not cool, then you're denying them their religious freedom. But the other thing I wanted to point out here is that one of the other things that he says would have been unthinkable 50 years ago is to have someone refuse to recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, what do you mean? No Jehovah's Witness, there was no one who, just based on their religious convictions, refused to recite the Pledge of Allegiance or swear an oath or anything like that.
Yeah, the
and that's
people
absurd.
In our audience may not know, but the Jehovah's Witnesses have had quite a number of Establishment Clause mm-hmm. lawsuits challenging being forced to pray and to, you know, bow down to a flag, these sorts of things. They reject that sort of thing. And, you know, what about their true expression of faith, you know? So...
Yeah.
What an amazing pack of lies. So just to wrap up that whole thing is like you take this patriot and you completely misquote him and completely garble the issue and you completely avoid what really is the issue, which is the Constitution
yeah.
and whether you're going to defend the Constitution, and you turn it into a mechanism to manipulate simpletons to give you money. What an amazing feat. Thank you, Mike. Good job.
Yeah.
Did you have something else you wanted to hear?
No.
No?
No, go ahead.
No? Okay. All right, well, let me switch gears. I got another thing I want to hit, and that is, what is this organization that he's plugging here, right? It must be important to him if he's telling all these lies to support it. It must be really important. The organization is called Renewing American Leadership, and... their stated purpose is to encourage leaders to spearhead renewal of American culture, which sounds vaguely okay, mm-hmm. whatever that means. Not very clear what that means. Number two is to advance and defend freedom and free markets. So if you've been listening so far, that might be smirk-worthy. And three, to encourage free expression of personal faith as a cultural norm, which is also kind of smirk-worthy. Okay, so that's... kind of the PC version of what they're doing. Now, the underlying theme of where they're coming from is this idea of American exceptionalism. And I talked about this a bit in a show I did a couple months ago when I was talking about Buzzwords of Ignorance, Judeo-Christian Nation. Mm-hmm. This is a concrete example of that sort of topic, right? And you can see on their website, if you look at their core doctrine 4 of 7, you will find an article that they've written, a white paper on American exceptionalism and Judeo-Christian values and all that. And let me unpack that for everybody so they can get an idea of where these guys are coming from. Okay, first off, U.S. is a superpower. We all sort of agree on that. And what they're claiming is that we're a superpower because of religious belief, mostly. But they have this problem. They can't ignore the fact that capitalism was a really big part of the U.S. rise to being a superpower. I mean, if we weren't capitalistic, we wouldn't be a superpower. Okay? So what they have to do is they have to tell a lie that capitalism is somehow biblical, which is very amusing, I think, right? So if you want to look at, like, some of the quotes of Jesus, right, in let's see, Matthew 19:21, and Jesus answered, "If you want to be perfect, go, sell your possessions, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." So, and you see that also in, let's see, Luke 12:33, if you follow along in your Bible, Luke 18:22, Matthew 6:19. They're all saying much the same thing. It's like sell everything you got and give away your money. But capitalism is a completely different thing, right? Capitalism is, man, I covet that thing. I'm going to go work my butt off and go get it, right? I'm going to go make the money to buy it, right? It's self-advancement, which is a completely foreign concept in the Bible, I think. Right, you're supposed to be, in the Bible, you're supposed to be subservient and obedient and follow follow the leader, be a little sheep, get shorn and you know.
Even if you're a slave, you're supposed to be cool with that and accept your lot in life and be the best slave you can be.
That's right. You know? That's right. So they've got this little problem that they're trying to promote capitalism, but they got this Jesus thing that they say they're also promoting, but it completely conflicts with it. And this whole American exceptionalism ignores the fact that, you know, we're an immigrant nation. We have people coming from a vast majority of cultures, and they've cross-fertilized and enriched our nation. Not having a world war at all on our soil has helped us, you know, not have to start from scratch like so much of Europe has done. That certainly plays into our superpower. What else? The fact that we have religious freedom and we have a broad number of religions, that's a big part of what makes us great, I think, is that we can not believe and we don't have to believe what they're selling. So what they're doing here is they're trying to steal credit for God, and then they're saying, oh, well, since we have the special relationship with God, we get to have the power, right? You have to follow us because we understand God's ways and these sorts of things. So at its core, this is a lie to grab power. That's the real reason behind this renewing American leadership. So renewal, what renewal means is you very often hear in Christian parlance words that start with re, like reconstruction and renewal and reclamation, these sorts of things. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to get to an idealistic past that never existed. The idea being that if we could just get back to our beliefs, all these terrible things that were happening would be good, would be all right.
Yeah, and actually there's actually a book out there called The Way We Never Were. It was written by, I think it's Stephanie Combs. Mm. She's a professor at Evergreen College.
Mm-hmm.
A really good book that talks about the way we never were and how people have all this nostalgia for a past that really is mythical as what's
right,
in the religious
right.
text here.
If you talk to white males in their 50s and 60s, they have a kind of nostalgic notion of the past, right? Because
yeah.
things were pretty good for white males. Yeah. If you're talking to women or blacks or whatever and that era, if they remember the past, things were not so good, right? So this
yeah.
really is kind of a particular cross section. Getting back to their core values, the second core value was advancing and defending freedom and free markets. Well, now we see where the free markets come from. Is they can't be saying that this is a bad thing if it's the source of so they're trying to mm-hmm. attach stuff to it. And the whole idea of freedom is really pretty amusing because it's very clear that they have no interest in freedom of believers that believe anything different than they do.
Right.
Right? That comes through very clear.
Oh, and in fact, there are specific attacks on Muslims in here.
There are. And attacks on atheists. And
yeah, equate Muslims with radical Islamic terrorists.
Mm-hmm.
And that's language that's
and they're different.
Prevalent in
they're
here.
Different.
Yeah.
And then the final thing of their organizational thing is to encourage the free expression of personal faith. Well, what they really want here is they want to sabotage the Establishment Clause, and they want to get into power so that they can express their faith and get people to follow them. So that's really what it is. So there's a number of warning signs that scare me about this organization. One is they have a clear contempt for the Establishment Clause of the Constitution. That comes across very clearly, and it's very clear in this letter. And I think this is effectively anti-American.
Yeah. Oh, yes, I agree.
And it's amazing to me that they have a 501c3 status, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is not a charity, and it's not an educational thing. It's overtly political. That's the second thing. Newt Gingrich is one of the big promoters of this, and one of the things they're plugging in here is this book where he went and found a bunch of God quotes on monuments. And well, you know, if you want to, you can find quotes that say, well, women should be subjected, and women are less than men. You know,
mm-hmm.
so what? It's not true, right? So just because certain people along the way believed in God doesn't mean very much. Another red herring, another problem I see is that David Barton is on their board. He's a propagandist. He's a liar. He makes up false false U.S. history promoting Christianity, and you know, he's just bad news all the way around. Another red flag for me is all the lies and deception in Huckabee's letter. I said there were 18 false statements that I counted. You know, you're welcome to go read the letter and count them yourself. 8 unsubstantiated claims, 15 deceptive statements, and 15 statements of emotional manipulation. So if their cause was a good thing, why would they need to lie?
Yeah.
It's just like religion. It's like if you use lies to advance your religion, you're admitting that it's crap. We already know it's crap. You know, why don't you tell us some truth? So, and I think that, you know, they're claiming that atheists are a real threat to America, but I think they're a real threat to America. I think that this is an insidious organization that is deceptive at its core, and I'm kind of creeped out by the whole thing.
Oh, yeah, and I mean, you know, you talked about this organization, and one of their goals is train a new generation of leaders who will defend our religious liberty and our schools and government. Well, that was the stated mission of Liberty University when Jerry Falwell founded that university. It was to basically raise, you know,
well, fundamentalists. I know he's created a law school that is tried to pump out, or was it Falwell?
I think that was Falwell.
Pat Robertson or Falwell, but
yeah, because I know Pat Robertson, I think, created an organization that it's sort of like the opposite of the ACLU. You know, it's the ACLU.
But it's the ACLJ or something.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. And
it's meant to basically fight church state separation, or
destroy church state separation. Yeah. And you know, they've been phenomenally successful because a lot of the people in the Bush administration, a lot of people in some of the most conservative organizations actually came from Falwell's university, Liberty University.
Mm-hmm. Well, I understand that during the Bush administration, there were a lot of staffers that came out of Regent and some of these other mills.
Regent. Yeah, Regent was, I think, Pat Robertson's university.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think you're right. He did.
Falwell likes the word liberty. You see that in. Anyway, that's most of what I had as far as this letter. I think we spent a lot of time. I don't know if you have other stuff you wanted to hit on this letter.
I think we've got three callers on the line here, so why don't we go ahead and take some calls here, and
great.
Then we can look at some of the stuff. Okay, so we've got.
Our phone's not lit up. We got a problem.
Guys, the phone's not working.
Okay, tech help, folks. We got no lights in here. Well, I can talk a little bit more about the letter. I have another little thing.
Okay.
Hopefully, we can clear up the phone problems in the meantime.
Yeah. Scott, if you're on, hang on. We'll get to you in just a second.
So I've made the claim earlier that this letter and this organization is a power grab, and I can tell you a little bit more of why I think it's a power grab, and in particular, there's a quote that I think is kind of amusing. Oh, and I should have done this quote earlier. America is an exceptional nation created out of the providence of God because of the prayers of people who, on their knees, begged for a place where they could be free and raise their children in faith. Sounds so heartwarming, doesn't it? So that's the quote I want to talk about. So there's this prayer idea. There's this idea that these people prayed and something wonderful happened. And it harkens back to also the Bible, like Mark 11:24, where Jesus promises, "Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours." Sounds pretty wonderful. Just pray and you're going to get your stuff. And this isn't a red herring. This appears in John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14. "Truly, truly, I say to you," this is Jesus talking, "he who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these that he will do, because I go to the Father wherever you ask my name, I will do it, and that the Father may be glorified in the Son, and if you ask anything in my name, I will do it." Because he claims to be God, and he claims to answer all the prayers. And furthermore, in Matthew 18:9, Jesus says, "Again, I say to you, If two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them in the name of my Father in heaven. So we have these folks saying, oh, this prayer is really wonderful stuff. But then a little later on in